Good evening, and welcome to Recovery at Cokesbury. My name is Jalissa. I'm a grateful believer in Jesus Christ, and I struggle with substance abuse, anxiety, and fear of abandonment. We're so glad you made a choice to be here tonight. We want you to know a few things about who we are, what we do, and why we're here. We love Jesus and have seen him work miracles. You can be the next miracle. This is a safe place. There are opportunities to share, ask questions, or simply just come and hang out with us. Recovery at Cokesbury is for anyone dealing with life challenges, relationship issues, chemical addiction, compulsive behavior, and loss. Scripture is the foundation for our teaching. The 12 steps are based on Scripture and are our daily tools for recovery. We encourage participation with AA, NA, and Al-Anon. True change and healing begin in our open share groups. Check one out tonight. For more information about our groups, please visit recovery@cokesbury.com. Thanks for joining us. We're confident you're in the right place. You'll be understood, respected, and loved here. And please remember, you are never alone.
Well, good evening, everybody. I haven't seen you in so long. I'm so glad to be here. Let's stand up together and let's worship. Sing with me, come on.
I wanna be close to you. I wanna be close to you. There's nothing in this world that compares to all you are. In the arms of the Father, there is love like no other. He who formed all things, he offers love to me.
You guys know my friend Aaron Tracy over here, don't you? That was not good enough. This is Aaron Tracy.
It's a blessing to be with you guys here today. Y'all sing along with us. The spirit of recovery is the spirit of the Lord. Can I get an amen? Sing these words. I count on one thing. The same God that never fails. I count on one thing. The same God that never fails will not fail me now. You won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God who's never late is working all things out. You're working all things out.
Or maybe this gets you started. That's good. Thank you, guys. I really appreciate it. Well, I am Lori, and I struggle with codependency. So my aim is to fix everyone in the room before we are done. Please line up. The kids are dismissed now, and you can go into the back, and you've got some great folks that are going to help you. It's a program that I wish I would have had when I was a kid. And then the announcements are no pictures, no videos. That's how we maintain anonymity. And divorce recovery is Tuesday. It's starting the 22nd. So that's going to be 6:30 to 8. Dinner is at 5:30. And there's childcare. And just let them know in the office, and you can sign up. So thanks for that. Okay, so we're going to get right to it. This is the part of the program where I do the biblical comparison, and I do the step, and we all do the biblical comparison together, and it's likely that I'd say stuff wrong tonight, so they love us too, so it's okay. All right, step one. We admitted we are powerless over our addictions and compulsive behaviors, that our lives have become unmanageable. I see there is another power within me that is at war with my mind. This power makes me slave to the brokenness that is still within me. Romans 7:23. And it's okay to speak up in here. You're among friends. Step two, we came to believe that a power greater than ourselves could restore us to sanity. When we are powerless to help ourselves, God showed his great love for us by sending Jesus to die for us. Romans 5:6. Step three, we made a decision to turn our will and life over to God. Therefore, I urge you, in view of God's mercy, offer yourselves as living sacrifices, holy and pleasing to God. This is your spiritual act of worship. Romans 12:1. Step four, we made a searching and fearless moral inventory of ourselves. Let us test and examine our ways, and let us return to the Lord. Lamentations 3:40. Step five, we admitted to God, to ourselves, and to another human being the exact nature of our wrongs. Confess your sins to each other and pray for each other so that you may be healed. James 5:16. Step six, we're entirely ready to have God remove all these defects of character. Anyone who belongs to Christ has become a new person. The old life is gone, a new life has begun. 2 Corinthians 5:17. Step seven, we humbly ask God to remove our shortcomings. If we confess our sins to God, God is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. 1 John 1:9. Step eight, we made a list of all persons we had harmed and became willing to make amends to them all. Search me, God, and know my heart. Test me and know my anxious thoughts. Point out anything in me that offends you and lead me along the path of everlasting life. Psalm 139:23-24. Step nine, we made direct amends to such people whenever possible, except when to do so would injure them or others. Instead, be kind to each other, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, just as God through Christ has forgiven you. Ephesians 4:32. Step 10, we continued to take personal inventory, and when we were wrong, promptly admitted it. Don't copy the behaviors of the customs of this world, but let God transform you into a new person by changing the way you think. Then you will learn to know God's will for you, which is good and pleasing and perfect. Romans 12:2. Step 11, we sought through prayer and meditation to improve our conscious contact with God, praying only for knowledge of his will for us and the power to carry that out. So let us come boldly to the throne of the gracious God. There we will receive his mercy, and we will find grace to help us when we need it most. Hebrews 4:16. And the giving back step, if you've been here for a year, you should return the favor to somebody around you or somebody in your influence. Here we go, step 12. Having had a spiritual awakening as a result of these steps, we tried to carry this message to others and to practice these principles in all our affairs. Jesus said, go home to your family and your friends and tell them everything the Lord has done for you and how merciful he has been. Mark 5:19. Yay. I appreciate that you guys really sang it out, so that's cool. Well, this is the part of the program that we get a chance to do a step 12, And this is a giving back for with your money. You can also help with your time. You can help lead somebody as a sponsor, and you can bring freedom to another person and another family. So there are some baskets up here, and if it's your first time, don't feel obligated to give. This ministry is being taken care of well by God. But if you have been coming for a while and been fed at this table, I encourage you to come up and provide an offering. Every penny that goes into these baskets goes to save a life, literally. So let's go to God in prayer. Sweet Jesus, thank you for this beautiful evening that you've provided, where your power is clearly present. Lord, may we feel your power in this room as we listen to the message and open our hearts. Thank you for providing this safe place for us tonight. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
God of Abraham, you're the God of covenant, faithful promises. Time and time again, you have proven you do just what you say. Though the storms may come and the winds may blow, I'll remain steadfast. And then my heart learned, when you speak a word, it will come to pass. Great is your faithfulness to history can prove there's nothing you can do. You're faithful and true. Though the storms may come and the winds may blow, I'll remain steadfast. And let my heart learn, when you speak a word, it will come to
you.
For those of you who were unaware, that's a really short bumper. And I'm slow. Good evening. My name is Alex. I'm a believer in Jesus Christ. I struggle with sexual integrity and anger issues. I also have an eating disorder, and it's really great to be back here with everybody once again. Before we pray, I just want to pose these questions, and these are the questions I'd like us to keep in mind as we get throughout things this evening. Am I seen? Am I worthy? Do I matter? Do I have value? Am I loved? I'm going to say those again. Am I seen? Am I worthy? Do I matter? Do I have value? Am I loved? Let's go to God in a word of prayer. God in heaven and God on earth, you are the creator, the redeemer, the sustainer, the mother and father of us all. Your Holy Spirit is the breath that fills our lungs. We are created by you for relationship with you and relationship with one another. We ask God that you would open our hearts, that you would open our minds, that you would key us in on your grace, your mercy, your wisdom, and your love this evening in this place. All these things we pray in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. So last week, Mark started us off on this book study by Robert McGee called Search for Significance. Mark gave kind of what I would call a 10,000-foot view of things last week. I'm going to bring us down to about the 1,000-foot level, and then over the next few weeks, we're going to bring it down to like the 100-foot level. So you may say to yourself, man, I heard this last week. Good. You were listening, and you probably need to hear it again. So this is where we're going to begin. Where does self-worth originate? I'm going to ask questions, and I might give some possible answers if we're lucky. So ask yourself these questions. How do I value myself currently? Why do I value myself that way? I want us to examine where our value system was introduced. Where does it come from? Is my system of values effective in my life? Now, ideally, self-worth is an internal state of being that comes from self-understanding, self-love, and self-acceptance. If you're like me and you're sitting in this room, either right now or at some point in life, you've probably been very short on self-understanding, self-love, and self-acceptance. Self-worth is a state that's somewhat timeless and unchanging because it's a direct measure of how I value myself, how I regard myself in spite of what others may say or do. That is the ideal. For most of my life, that was an incredibly unfamiliar ideal. Self-worth is the internal sense of being good enough and worthy of love and belonging. Man, this sounds like a completely foreign concept. Yet we often look outside ourselves to find self-worth. And I know you guys saw this last week, this equation right here. Self-worth equals performance and the opinions of others. Self-worth equals performance plus other people's opinions. I even remember recently going to my therapist and he asked me to talk about myself and tell him how I understood myself. And I was like, man, I don't know, just ask these other people. Like, they know me a whole lot better than I know myself. And he let that slide. I need a new therapist. What I'm about to say needs to be prefaced by an understanding that God does not exist alone in this world, that evil exists in this world, and that we often describe that evil as Satan. And that Satan deceives people into believing that the basis of their worth is their performance and ability to please others. I have a spiritual director who told me not that long ago that Satan doesn't tell us the wrong thing. Satan tells us the right thing, just a little bit off center. It looks good. It sounds good. It very well may be good. I promise you, it is not good. There are two options here. If we base our worth solidly on the truth of God's word, if we base our self-worth solidly on the truth of God's word, then our behavior will reflect God's love, God's grace, and God's power. But if we base our worth on our own abilities or the fickle approval of others, then our behavior will reflect insecurity, fear, and anger that come from that kind of instability. Didn't I just say I struggle with anger? That's a huge root of this. If I base my self-worth and performance in other people's opinions, then my values reflect a false narrative. And there are two possible results, two possible outcomes of this false narrative. They are perfectionism or compulsion and withdrawal. Perfectionism is marked by a compulsive desire for control. Achievement, status, relationships, they're not for mutual gain. When I live in compulsion, when I live in an addiction and compulsive behavior, it's about what I can get out of it. And it's important that it's a compulsive desire for control, and it's important because control, I think, is a very underlying aspect of all addictions and compulsive behaviors. I think at the root of all addictions and compulsive behaviors is this basis of fear. And it may help to understand that fear rooted in insecurity, not fear as we may necessarily see it. So it's both and. But it all boils down to fear and control is just fear-based. Withdrawal, on the other hand, is marked by the avoidance of failure and disapproval, primarily by avoiding risk altogether. So, in compulsion, in perfectionism, it's everything has to be done just so, and it has to be right, because that gives me the semblance of control. In withdrawal, I'm just not gonna do it, because if I don't do it, I can't do it incorrectly. Right? There's no point in starting if I know I'm not gonna get it done the way I want it to get done. In this model, self-worth equals performance and others' opinions, we base our security on success and those opinions. We become dependent on our ability to perform and our ability to please others. This leads us to develop a have-to mentality. That have-to mentality says things like, I have to do well on this exam, or my security as a good student will be threatened. I have to make that deal, or my boss will think I'm a failure. My father, my mother, my spouse, my friend, they have to appreciate me and be happy with my decisions, because I cannot cope with their disapproval. If they're upset, whoever they are, if they are upset, my whole world will come to an end. After all, am I not responsible for everyone else's happiness? I've said it before and I will say it again. The amount of time that I have spent worrying about what other people think about me is for naught. Because we're all those narcissistic egotists at some point on the inside. It's about ego and it's about pride, and it comes back to like, listen, I'm much more concerned about myself than anybody else is. That's it. And the only person whose happiness I'm really responsible for is mine. So if I fall into this have-to mentality, I have to find some way from moving out of a have-to mentality into a want-to motivation. I want to answer those questions I asked at the very beginning that some of you wrote down and some of you have already forgotten and some of you haven't stopped thinking about. I am seen. I am worthy. I matter. I have value. I am loved. You are seen. You are worthy. You matter. You have value. You are loved. That worth has freely and conclusively been given by God. Therefore, failure and disapproval of others cannot take it away. Not now, not ever. We don't have to be slaves to performance and the opinions of others because we are secure and free in Jesus Christ. It would be nice to have the approval of others. But regardless of that approval, I am accepted and loved by God. I don't know how many conversations Mark has had with people and said, if the only thing you had was you and God, would that be enough? Let's face it. I know a lot of us have lost it all, really. Lost relationships, lost marriages, lost loved ones, lost friends in this program due to this disease. And due to our own poor life choices. We don't have everything we once had. I have God. I have the fellowship. I have the tools of the program. Without that, I don't have a whole lot else. Which takes us to this next point. This is the Parent Trap, not to be confused with either of the movies by the same name. Who is the basis for how you understand God? Typically, the critical and formative relationships in our lives are, at least in the early stages, our images for God. We broken people associate unhealthy authority figures in our lives with God. If that's not a recipe for disaster and failure, I'm not really sure what is. So God is usually a mirror of our parents' attitude toward us. That's the way we know ourselves. Through our parents, our grandparents, our teachers, our mentors, our pastors, our Sunday school teachers, etc., and so forth. What McGee says is that we need to dismantle that false connection and foster a real connection. Right, so one of the things that I was told before I went to graduate school, and I went to a seminary to learn how to do things like this, was that when you go there, imagine that all of your beliefs about God and the Bible are like this brick wall. And all of those bricks have been placed there by the people we just talked about, by my parents, my grandparents, my teachers, my mentors, my Sunday school teachers. They have given me my faith and my understanding. And in grad school, the job of my professors was to knock down that wall. And my role was to figure out which of those pieces to pick back up and what new pieces I was going to use to rebuild that wall of faith and understanding. That's what I think we want to talk about right now. All right? So this includes a false idea of a strong relationship with God. And I thought I had a strong relationship with God. I didn't start going to church till I was 12 or 13, and I walked through that door because a girl asked me to, which that's all I needed. And I never stopped going through that door. I was in the door of the church down the street every time it was open. And I played on the praise team, and I sang, and I was a representative in the youth group, and I went to school the first time for ministry I mean, there were 5 majors in 9 years between high school and the end of my undergraduate career. But, you know, I thought I had a really close relationship with God. I was very actively involved in the church. I read the Bible. I participated in small groups. But I had a false idea of a strong relationship with God. I had the facade of a strong relationship with God. I looked the part, and I could walk and talk the part. But on some level, I still pictured God as my concierge or a genie or a short order cook. God was there to serve me. I was not there to serve God. I was not there to allow God to tell me who I am supposed to be. I was there telling God who I wanted God to be and what I wanted God to do for me. What happens is this creates a God who's aloof, demanding, cruel. And then we can also create illegitimate gods from our parents, from ourself, and from our addictions. Since for most of us, our parents are our first version of God, a lot of people, even people raised in good Christian homes, whatever that means, don't have a picture of unconditional love. Because so many of us have grown up with the idea that if I behave a certain way, then I will be loved and affirmed. Those of you who don't know my story, I was born intentionally of a young mother who was getting ready to turn 18. She knew she was going to draw Social Security and she could draw more money if she had a child. So she thought it would be a good idea to get knocked up, realized she could not handle having a child, passed me off to her mother, and I was adopted out of that situation. In the past, I placed a lot of blame on her. She was an 18-year-old kid trying to do her best in the situation she was in. I don't really fault her or blame her for that anymore, but the parents who raised me were really great image bearers of God, which is interesting because they have zero relationship with a God of any kind. But a couple years ago, I don't have any tattoos right now, but I've always wanted to get some ink, and I kind of asked for what should I get if I was going to get something, and my mom called me and she was like, listen, you need to get the word always tattooed. And I was like, why? And I was a hellacious child. I had temper tantrums like nobody's business on into adulthood. And I was the youngest of 3 boys. And neither of my brothers had the kind of behavioral problems that I had. But when I would fly off the handle, and I'd become completely inconsolable, kicking, screaming, yelling, hitting. And I don't remember this, because I don't remember a lot of things that happened while I was in a rage. But my mother told me that my father would wrap me up and just like take me in his arms and hold me such that I couldn't flail. And they would repeat over and over again, we love you always. We will always love you. We love you always. There's nothing that you can say or do that will make us change our mind. We love you always. I'm fortunate that I have that picture, that I had that understanding and image of God when I first came to understand who God could be. Most people don't have that. But I think if there is an earthly image of what our God should look like, that's it. Right? Then another illegitimate God can be myself, which is a total disaster, right? My higher power looks like me, and I become my own God, which is what I do in not just active addiction. It's probably what I did this morning when I just did what I wanted to do. I end up trying to restore sanity to my life via my own thoughts and deeds. And then I can make the addiction or compulsive behavior my God, right? Life then becomes about the chase or the journey. We think we're controlling life. Well, it's really been controlling us all along, and substitute your addiction of choice there, and that pretty much holds true. So some of you are in our Tuesday night 12-step study, and you're reading the book Hunger for Healing by Keith Miller. Miller says this. This is a story that he tells. One day, I heard a new man in the program say to an old timer, "No way I'm going to turn my life over to God. He'd ruin me, and I deserve it." For him, God was a giant policeman, and his experience with police was not all that positive. The old timer, a strong, quiet man, listened to the new man's description of God, and then in all seriousness said, "You ought to fire that God. You've got the wrong God for this program, friend. The God who operates here is loving, forgiving, and gives you all the chances you need to get the program. That God is honest and will always be there for you. I had a God like yours when I first came in here, but I had to fire that God and get a new one. What can I do about a God if I fire mine?" the new man asked. "You can use mine till you get on your feet." There's nothing like holding hope for the newcomer who cannot do so for themselves. I can't even describe the experience any other way. In the Step into Action, which is a 12-step workbook for Sexaholics Anonymous, there are member stories in each chapter about each step. And I think this is like story 7 on step 2. One of the guys says these things. "The God I need is a God who loves me unconditionally, is always on my side, gives me whatever I need to overcome obstacles and grow, is blameless for pain, suffering, and evil, is omnipotent, and will eventually reveal all mysteries. This God I can trust. I have to." And I want to point out that third bullet, "gives me whatever I need to overcome obstacles and grow," does not give me whatever I want, and does not give me whatever I need. Gives me whatever I need to overcome obstacles and grow. It's a God who respects me. That's a God who challenges me, who I know is doing so because that God loves me. Miller goes on to say, "As I watched the higher power reveal itself to various people in the group, its personality always had certain definite familiar characteristics. I knew that if everyone were making up their higher power, this wouldn't happen. The personality of the higher power revealed in those meetings was always loving and forgiving, gave people however many new starts they needed to get into recovery and to get well, was rigorously honest, moral, courageous, and strong, but never abusive, and was loyal beyond belief whether people deserved it or not. In fact, as I look carefully at the higher power in the 12-step program, I realize that it had a haunting family resemblance to Jesus Christ. We learn to have our emotional needs met by getting involved in healthy fellowship groups where there's evidence of people knowing and being in relationship with the real Jesus. That is the real connection we need to make." You see, the real Jesus can handle whatever we throw at him. It's okay to be angry with God. It's okay to have healthy conflict with God. If it's not okay to be mad at God, then I'm forced to leave God's presence Throughout the Psalms, David models all sorts of conflict with God. God is more than big enough to deal with the full range of human emotions and whatever I want to throw God's way. After all, you and I, we were made in the image of God. Paul has this to say. Therefore, since we have been made right in God's sight by faith, we have peace with God because of what Jesus Christ our Lord has done for us. Because of our faith, Christ has brought us into this place of undeserved privilege where we now stand, and we confidently and joyfully look forward to sharing God's glory. We can rejoice too when we run into problems and trials, for we know that they help us develop endurance. And endurance develops strength of character, and character strengthens our confident hope of salvation. And this hope will not lead to disappointment, for we know how dearly God loves us, because he has given us the Holy Spirit to fill our hearts with his love. When we were utterly helpless, Christ came at just the right time and died for us sinners. Now, most people would not be willing to die for an upright person, though someone might perhaps be willing to die for a person who is especially good. But God showed his great love for us by sending Christ to die for us while we were still sinners. While we were still addicts, while we were still in codependent relationships, while we were still drunk in a ditch somewhere with our families worried about where we might be, Christ died for us. And since we've been made right in God's sight by the blood of Jesus, he will certainly save us from God's condemnation. For since our friendship with God was restored by the death of his son while we were still his enemies, we will certainly be saved through the life of this son. So now we can rejoice in our wonderful new relationship with God because our Lord, Jesus Christ, has made us friends of God. Will we accept Christ's death as payment for our sins and discover the powerful implications of our salvation? Or will we continue to follow Satan's lies and deceptions? Satan's gonna keep showing us the right thing, just a little bit off center. It's so easy to chase after that. If you were to die today, what would be on your list of reasons to spend eternity with God? Abilities, church participation, kindness, ministry, abstinence, good deeds. Nothing wrong with those. But when Jesus, our Savior, revealed his kindness and love, he saved us. Not because of the right things we had done, but because of his mercy. We must give up our own efforts to achieve righteousness and instead believe that Christ's death and resurrection alone are sufficient to pay for our sin and separation from God. Are you seen? Are you worthy? Do you matter? Do you have value? Are you loved? You bet you are. You are seen. You are worthy. You have value. You matter. And you are loved. That's true from God. That's true from Jesus. That's true for me. That's true for me. And it's true for you. Because Jesus came and walked this earth. Jesus came and showed us the way. Jesus took the life that had been breathed into him and paid the ultimate price that we may be freely forgiven no matter where we've been, no matter who we are, no matter what we've done, and no matter what we continue to do. God's the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow, but we don't have to be. Amen? Would you pray with me? God, you are our God, and we will ever praise you. The breath in our lungs was breathed out by your Holy Spirit into us, that we may not only know God, but that we may have God living inside of us, that we may be a light in the darkness, that when people see us, they see not the person we used to be, but the person you have called us to be, and the person whose heart and mind you have changed and continue to change for the better. You transform us and conform us to your will, to your heart, and to your mind through the grace and mercy of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who died, rose from the dead, and ascended to heaven. Nobody else can say that. I am free. I am forgiven. Brothers and sisters, now is your opportunity to come and declare that truth to be yours here this evening. You can come pray at this altar. You can come receive a white chip to celebrate your brand new life if you want to surrender and give it all away. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, we pray in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen.
Savior, I come, quiet my soul. Remember, redemption's here with your blood us here. Everything I once held dear, I count it all as loss. Lead me to the cross where your love poured out. Bring me to my knees, Lord, I lay me down. Rid me of myself, I belong to you. To your heart. to the cross where you love poured out. Bring me to my knees, Lord, I lay me down. Bring me of myself, I belong to you.
How about that? Give Dina a round of applause. We love it that the band is coming back little by little. Well, if you want to hear some more about that rebuilding of the bricks that Alex was talking about, come to one of the small groups. It's probably raining outside anyway. And that's really where the good stuff is in the small groups. You get to have a sense of family. You get accepted for all your warts and all by somebody else who's also got them, right? They're here too. So it's really, really good. All right, let's stand up and close in the serenity prayer. God, grant me the serenity to accept the things I cannot change, the courage to change the things I can, and the wisdom to know the difference. Living one day at a time, enjoying one moment at a time, accepting hardship as a pathway to peace, taking as Jesus did this sinful world as it is, not as I would have it, trusting that he will make all things right if I surrender to his will, that I may be reasonably happy with him and... there you go. The next. Amen.